I want to go through our top 10 players of the baseball decade, and we're going to tell you why we think they're top 10 and the reasoning behind it. Are you ready, Speedy?
Let's go.
Let's go. Let's get it.
All right, so number 10, here's one that I think gets undervalued because he hasn't been good in a while, but he was one of the more steady closers in this decade. I'm going to say Craig Kimbrell, number 10. He was dominant with Atlanta. And again, a lot for a position, for the closing position, that you see phases. You see a lot of guys are good for a little while, but then they'll phase out. Craig Kimbrell and one of the other guys I'll mention later were really the only two consistent closers in that time. Craig Kimbrell was borderline Cy Young candidate in some years with the Braves, some early 2010s Braves teams that were very good. So he's my number 10. He hasn't been as good lately for the Red Sox, but again, I would say from 2010 to 2017, he was one of the most steady guys we've ever seen.
My number 10 is Chris Sale. He's been one of the most dominant American League pitchers in the last 10 years. This is a guy that won an American League Cy Young. He won one World Series with the Boston Red Sox. This is a guy that's been a champion. And really, what he did with Chicago at the time that he did it, and especially demanding not to play. Remember that? When he didn't want to play with the jersey situation.
Jersey, yep.
I mean, this guy has been a mindset not only for the pitching position and the way he throws the ball, the underarm. It's really, the game is not the same that it once was, and the pitcher is not the same as it once was. So I think Chris Sale, the dominance and the power pitching that he has provided in the last 10 years, it's been remarkable. So he's my number 10.
All right, number 9 for me, Madison Bumgarner. I think he's a guy that hasn't been the amazing regular season pitcher, but again, that the postseason stuff has really just been putting him to another level. And again, later on, he became a more steady regular season guy into 2013 through probably about 2017 before he had that ATV accident. So I think what he's done in that time, you really have to give him a lot of credit for that postseason. It was the best World Series ERA that we've ever seen in 2014. And he was dominant even in 2010 when he was the fourth guy in that rotation. When they had Lincecum and they had Matt Cain, he was very good in that postseason too. And that comeback, remember, they were fourth place at the All-Star break. So he's been very good for a while. And we'll see how he comes back now with the Diamondbacks. But again, probably outside of the last two seasons, he's really been a steady force in this entire decade and, again, dominant in the postseason.
My number 9 is another Boston Red Sox, Mr. Mookie Betts. And Mookie Betts, an MVP, and really, in the last six years, he's been one of the best hitters in baseball, one of the best defensive players in baseball, plays multiple positions, really a dominant player, especially in the World Series that they won a couple of years ago. He was one of the best players on the team throughout the season, and that's why he won the MVP. And really, what this Boston Red Sox team over the last couple of years has just been remarkable, and he's one of the main reasons why, and the mainstay of players that has been the reason why the Boston Red Sox in their dominance. So my number 9 is Mookie Betts.
All right, number 8 for me, I'm going to say Yadier Molina. I think Yadier Molina, when you look at everything he's done, all the great defensive prowess that he has, working with a lot of different pitchers. The Cardinals change players a lot. We see them have a quick leash on a lot of their pitchers, and Yadier Molina's worked well with all of them. And in addition to that, he's also a great offensive catcher. Won a batting title, won an MVP, hit 300 or close to 300 a lot of his career. And even a couple of years ago, hit over 22 home runs. So when you look at a steady dominance of a catcher, just one of the smartest, if not the smartest, baseball IQ in the league. And again, him just being so great defensively at a position in the catcher where, again, it's undervalued, but it's very important on the field when in terms of being the smartest guy and working with the pitchers and the other fielders.
My number 8 is also a catcher, but it's not Mr. Molina. It's Mr. Posey. And Mr. Posey, he's been one of the best dominant catchers in the last 10 years. He won a couple of World Series. He was a big part of those World Series runs. And really, with all the dominant pitching that the Giants have had year in and year out with Bumgarner and all the different pitchers they've had over the years, he was one of the main guys and one of the main reasons why these pitchers produced and became the Cy Young candidates that he once was. So it's Buster Posey as my number 8.
Alrighty. Number 7 for me, I will take the other closer I was talking about in Aroldis Chapman. I think for a long time he was that other guy. He was the lefty version. Him and Kimbrell were on and off of who was the best closer in baseball. And again, both of them have been so consistent. I think Chapman surpassed him now definitively, but it was always very close. And again, 106 miles an hour that he threw at Cincinnati. Again, he was on some good Cincinnati Reds teams in the early part of the decade. They kind of obviously fizzled out after that, but he was very consistent for a while. He then went to the Yankees, then he went to the Cubs, he went back to the Yankees, and obviously he's been very steady for a very long time, and again, still has that velocity in him. to be able to be just one of the most dominant closers. And probably another year or two, you could talk about him in the Hall of Fame discussion, because he's got the monumental amount of saves, too.
My number seven is Miguel Cabrera, Triple Crown winner, dominant player. And even if he has really died down as a player in the major leagues, especially with the Detroit Tigers his last couple of years, this guy has been one of the most dominant hitters in 2010 all the way to 2014. He was as good as anybody in the league. And even though aging and really as the player that he once was, he's not anywhere close to the player that he once was. He is the last player since Mickey Mantle to win a Triple Crown. So it's a remarkable career, and I think Miguel Cabrera is, I wouldn't put him in my top five, but in my top 10, you have to put him there.
I'm going to go with number six. I'm going to go with a guy with some very good longevity. How about Adrian Beltre? I mean, for a while, he was a dominant third baseman. How long he played? He was a rookie in 2004, and he only just retired in 2018. Steadily was healthy. He had a couple injury issues at the end of his career, but steadily healthy, one of the best defensive third basemen at his time, and one of the more consistent hitters, great playoff player for the Rangers when they went to their back-to-back World Series. And I think, again, he's somebody, 3,000 hits, he's somebody that will definitely get into the Hall of Fame at some point. Or you would think in realistic standpoints, but who knows at this rate with the way the baseball writers are. So number six, I'll say Adrian Beltre.
My number six is Adrian Beltre, too. I agree with you. I'm looking at some of his numbers. This guy is a Hall of Fame player. He's been his longevity in the league. And really what he's done, everywhere he's gone, he's been a leader. And the special ability that he has as not only a Spanish player, but as a player growing up as a major league player, played with a lot of great players. His development of really, I think he's a future manager in the major league.
I can say that, yeah.
And a leader. The leadership that the tools that he has as a defensive player is one of the greatest third baseman defensive players we've ever seen. And power, he adds power. And he hits for 300, too.
Yeah.
So he's just a credible player. Adrian Beltre is my number six.
All right, number five, I'm going to go with a pitcher that's still dominating currently and has really been dominating since 2012 in this postseason. It's Max Scherzer. Max Scherzer, when you look at it, he was a number three, number four guy, kind of like Bumgarner in that postseason. That postseason really got him going, and then since then, he's just been one of the best regular season pitchers we've ever seen, and was dominant in the postseason, too, this year for the Nationals in their World Series run. Phenomenal stuff, great curveball, great fastball, and again, he's been very steady, very durable for the most part. He had those thumb issues this year, but again, really beyond that, he's been extremely durable, and he's won two Cy Youngs. He's been in the conversation pretty much every year and very consistent as a whole, really from 2012 to today, and he's still one of the best pitchers in baseball today.
My number five is Clayton Kershaw, the dominant pitcher that he was really the last 15 years, 12 years, the dominance that he is, but he has not really produced in the playoffs, and that's been his problem. And if you look him at as a player, really the dominance of a pitcher with the LA Dodgers and what he did for the Dodgers organization the last couple of years with Joe Torre coming to the team. And Joe Torre said, imagine Joe Torre coming out and saying that he's the best pitcher he's ever coached. And you're talking about Andy Pettit, some of the great pitchers he had with the New York Yankees over the years in his championship Yankee teams, like the David Wells and the Roger Clemens and all the other pitchers that he's had. He says that Clayton Kershaw is the best pitcher he's ever coached. So to me, what Clayton Kershaw has done in the regular season has been absolutely remarkable. When you talk about Peyton Manning and comparing their careers together, both guys have been dominant in the regular season, and they really weren't as dominant of players in the playoffs as they were in the regular season. So if you compare him to a Peyton Manning, you can't knock him off the board because it is Peyton Manning. So Clayton Kershaw is my number five.
All right, number four, I'm going to take probably the second best pitcher when you come looking at judging recently is Justin Verlander. Another guy that's been kind of up and down in the playoffs. He's been great at times, especially in 2012 when they went to the World Series. But again, he's been up and down. I think that's really the only knock on him. But again, beyond that, he's been very steady. He had a couple bad years in 2014 and 15, but that was really it when judging this decade. He's been rebirthed nicely since he's gone to the Astros. But again, when he was pitching, he was a strikeout guy, fastball guy, curveball guy. He could do everything and was amazing statistically. So Justin Verlander, number four for me.
Number four is Jacob deGrom. And I'll tell you why Jacob deGrom. How many pitchers you know in the National League won back-to-back Cy Young Awards in the last 10 years? Not many. And Jacob deGrom, I don't care what anybody says, well, he hasn't been dominant in the last 10 years. But the last 3 or 4 years, he's been one of the most dominant pitchers in baseball. Go look at his numbers. He had a career year a couple of years ago, 1.77 ERA. Dominant pitcher, won the Cy Young, back-to-back Cy Youngs, and he had a Cy Young with a losing record. How many pitchers you've seen done do that in the last couple?
I think
of
the
years?
Only other one was Zach Greinke when he was with the Royals.
Also, the guy that played for the
Felix Hernandez.
Felix Hernandez, so. Yeah, Felix Hernandez too. So he's had a remarkable career so far, and he was drafted as a shortstop and really transitioned as a pitcher. It's a remarkable story and a remarkable career, and I think this guy's been as dominant as any pitcher in the last 10 years. So Jacob DeGrom is my
Number three for me is a guy you mentioned earlier in Buster Posey. I think again, when you look at him, just tremendous regular season and postseason. Good offensive catcher, hit 300. I think he hit 330 one year in his batting title year. He won an MVP. Again, until just recently, very durable for the most part. Again, great defensive catcher, great with working with a lot of different pitchers. And again, he's had some injury issues lately, but again, for the most part, throughout the whole decade and his postseason prowess, you got to put Buster Posey up there.
Number three, Max Scherzer. I mean, you put him at your number five. I put him at my number three. He has been as dominant as any pitcher in baseball the last 10 years. You want to talk about a guy that has won a couple of Cy Youngs? This guy has been on the top three Cy Young award winner, you know, on the top three voting for Cy Young for the last 7 or 8 years. He's been the most dominant player since he's gone to the Washington Nationals, and he was a big part of their World Series championship last year. They brought him to win a championship. He finally won that championship, and what he's done really remarkable, being traded the way he was from Arizona to Detroit, mm-hmm. and really having the career that he has with Detroit and then going to the Nationals, has been a remarkable career. This guy is a first ballot Hall of Famer. Max Scherzer as my number three.
All right, number two is who you just mentioned a little bit earlier, is Clayton Kershaw. I think he's been the best pitcher of this era when you look at it. Yeah, the postseason is what's keeping him from being number one, because he hasn't gotten it done in the postseason. But as we were talking about with Tracy, I mean, who says his legacy wouldn't have changed if the Astros didn't cheat and he finally got it over it in Game 5? Because he pitched well in one of those World Series games, too. Keep that in mind. I think it was Game 1 or Game 2 in L.A. So he's definitely been the best statistical pitcher. I think he was 3 Cy Youngs and, again, a lot of strikeouts. Probably the best curveball in terms of a generational pitch that we have in the game right now. One of the best we've ever seen, and definitely going to be a Hall of Famer when his time comes. Again, the only thing stopping him from being number one is, can he get it done in the playoffs?
Justin Verlander as my number two. He's been the most dominant pitcher in my eyes in the last 10 years. And I know I have Carl saying, why isn't Rizzo on the list? Rizzo is still
too early.
He's still early, and to me, we're looking at the last 10 years, and Rizzo hasn't been a top player in the league for the last 10 years. So really, Justin Verlander has been the most dominant player and pitcher in the last 10 years. Pitcher, I'm sorry, not player. But really, his dominance in the American League, and in the American League, which dominant has been dominant from the National League for the last 10 years. The power hitting, the DH position has really transitioned the game, especially in the American League. And I just think Justin Verlander winning the championship with Houston, yes, they cheated, but this is a guy that has been a Cy Young candidate for the last 10 years. He's been amongst the league's top four, top five pitchers. So dominant pitcher, and he's gotten better as he gotten older. So Justin Verlander as my number two.
And number one is the best player in baseball currently, Mike Trout. I mean, how could you not say Mike Trout for a guy that's been so consistent? He had one injury-riddled year in 2017, but his pace to what he would have done in that season even too was amazing. He was on pace to have almost 50 home runs, I think hit 320 something in that season too. He's just been so good everywhere. Power, stolen bases, defense, fantastic. He's the best player in baseball and has been really for the last, I would say, 6 years since he came up in 2012.
And Carl's arguing his point right now. He says Rizzo over Beltre. Beltre is, to me right now, Beltre is a better player. He just is. Longevity and what he's done at the position. Go look at his numbers. Go look at what he has done in the league as a defensive player, as an offensive player. Rizzo hasn't won the gold gloves that Beltre has won.
Right.
So it's a different... You can argue your points. And Jacob DeGrom, yes, you're right. Jacob DeGrom doesn't deserve it. But Jacob DeGrom has won back-to-back Cy Youngs. And there are not many pitchers have done that in the last 10 years. So Jacob DeGrom's on my list because of his dominance as a pitcher the last couple of years. So as far as I'm concerned, it's Mike Trout. Mike Trout has been the best player in baseball for the last 5 years, 6 years. He's been an MVP candidate practically every single year, year in and year out. The fact that he hasn't won back-to-back-to-back-to-back MVPs doesn't make any sense to me. He deserves it. And really, what he is as a baseball player, and really, he is not the face of baseball. That's what makes him so special, is he's not the face of baseball right now because he plays for the Anaheim Angels and a team that really doesn't get showcased enough, like the Yankees, like the Dodgers, like the Houston Astros. So It's absolutely Mike Trout. He's been the best player in baseball and could go down as one of the top five, top three best baseball players if he can stay healthy for the rest of his career.